This is Janet and Rabia.
Welcome to Everest Physics Academy.
Before we start, we'd like to recommend our Everest Physics books for high school,
where you can find more explanations and solve applications and the problems.
In this video, we will introduce the general expression of Newton's second law, derive the equation of the center of mass theorem, define an isolated system and prove the conservation of its linear momentum, calculate the recoil velocity from the principle of conservation of linear momentum.
General expression of Newton's second law. First, let me remind you with the simple form of Newton's second law. Sigma F external is equal to ma. The net force acting on the system is equal to the mass of the system multiplied by the acceleration. Now let's move to the general expression of Newton's second law. The time derivative of the linear momentum of a particle is equal to the vector sum of the external forces acting on this particle. So the net force acting on the particle is equal to the first derivative of its linear momentum with respect to time. It can be easily shown that this formula is applicable also for a system of particles. So we have sigma F external, the net force acting on the system of particles, is equal to the first derivative of the linear momentum of the system with respect to time. Now let's move to the center of mass theorem. We have seen in the last episode that the linear momentum of a system of constant mass is equal to the linear momentum of its center of mass, which is equal to the mass of the whole system multiplied by the velocity of its center of mass. Now let's apply the general expression of Newton's second law to this system. So we have the net force acting on the system is equal to the derivative of the linear momentum of the system with respect to time. Now, replace P system by mvg. This is going to be dmvg by dt. Now, denote m by u and denote vg by v. So, the derivative would be u prime v plus u v prime. So we have dme by dt is u prime, vg is v, m is u, and ag is v prime. But remember, we are studying only systems with constant mass. So dme by dt, which is equal to m prime, is equal to zero. So we still have sigma F external is equal to mag. Now the last result is called center of mass theorem, which states that the vector sum of the external forces acting on a system of constant mass is equal to the product of the mass of the system by the acceleration of its center of mass.
Conservation of linear momentum. If a system is subjected to more than one external force, as in one of the three following figures. In figure 1, we have two external forces acting on the system. In figure 2, we have three external forces acting on the system. While in figure 3, we have n external forces acting on the system. If the sum of the external forces acting on a system is zero, then the system is said to be isolated or mechanically isolated. What is the consequence of an isolated system? By applying the general expression of Newton's second law, which is the sum of the external forces acting on the system is equal to the time derivative of its linear momentum, if the vector sum of these forces is zero, we can simply deduce that dp system by dt is also equal to zero. But we know that when the derivative of a quantity is equal to zero, then this quantity must be constant or conserved. So we conclude that the linear momentum of an isolated system is conserved or P system initial equal P system final.
Focus, please. This is important.
Applications on the conservation of linear momentum. The conservation of linear momentum explains some situations in daily life, like explosions and collisions, which will be discussed in the next episodes. We have also the recoil of objects, like the recoil of a soldier's shoulder when shooting a gun, and the recoil of a cannon when ejecting a shell, which will be our example in this episode. Now consider this figure. In the first figure, you have a cannon containing a shell, and the cannon is at rest. And in the second figure, when the cannon ejects the shell with a velocity u, it recoils with a velocity v. Now in this situation, we want to neglect the friction between the cannon and the ground. And we have a question for you. Why does the cannon recoil when ejecting the shell? And the answer is, let's take the cannon shell system. Now, what are the external forces acting on the cannon? So we have the weight of the cannon and the shell, of course. So it is M plus M into G, where capital M is the mass of the cannon and small m is the mass of the shell. We have also the normal force N exerted by the ground on our system. Take into account that the normal force exerted by the cannon on the shell is an internal force, okay? So it is not one of the external forces acting on our system. Now, the shell and the cannon move horizontally, and the external forces are vertical forces, so their sum is zero. Therefore, our system is an isolated system and its linear momentum is conserved. So we have P system initial is equal to P system final.
The system is initially at rest. So the linear momentum of the system just before the ejection is equal to zero. Therefore, the linear momentum of the system just after the ejection is also equal to zero. But the system is composed of the shell and the cannon. So P system after the ejection can be written as P shell plus P cannon. P shell is the linear momentum of the shell and P cannon is the linear momentum of the cannon just after the ejection. But P shell is equal to the small m times u. Small m is the mass of the shell and u is the velocity of the shell. P cannon is equal to the capital M times V. Capital M is the mass of the cannon and V is the velocity of the cannon just after the ejection. Rearrange. So the velocity of the cannon is equal to minus small m over capital M times the velocity of the shell. Now, what does this minus sign represent? Since the small m over the capital M is always positive, so V and U have opposite directions. Therefore, the cannon recoils with a velocity V whose direction is opposite to that of the ejection of the shell. Now, the mass of the shell over the mass of the cannon is much less than 1, since the mass of the cannon is much greater than that of the shell. We can conclude that the speed of the cannon after the ejection is much less than that of the shell.
Thank you for watching. If you like this video,
subscribe to the channel, hit the like button, and share.